Good morning, everybody. My name is Nicola Phillips. I'm the Provost of the University of Melbourne. I'd like to start off by acknowledging that we're gathered here this morning on the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and I would like to pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. Today, we're honoured to welcome you all to the University of Melbourne to celebrate this historic India-Australia Economic Cooperation and Trade Agreement. I would like to extend our warmest welcome to India's Minister of Commerce and Industry, Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution and Textiles, the Honourable Piyush Goyal. I'd also like to extend our warmest welcome to Australia's Minister for Trade, Tourism and Investment, the Honourable Dan Tehan. It's wonderful to have you back, Minister, so soon after your recent visit to launch the update of the India Economic Strategy hosted here by the Australia-India Institute. Thank you. I'd also like to acknowledge our distinguished guests, His Excellency the High Commissioner of India, Mr. Manpreet Vora, India's Consul General in Melbourne, Mr. Raj Kumar, and of course the Chancellor of the University of Melbourne and the Chairman of the Australia-India Institute, Mr. Alan Myers, ACQC. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, 2022 has already been a momentous year for the Australia-India relationship. This year alone, we've seen significant announcements and developments between the two countries, including a Quad meeting in Melbourne, the second India-Australia virtual summit between both prime ministers, during which a funding injection of $280 million was announced by the Morrison government, the release of the India Economic Strategy update, and of course, the reason that we're gathered here today, the signing of the Australia-India Economic Cooperation and Trade Agreement. The University of Melbourne particularly welcomes the terms of that agreement that focus on students, education, and research. Here at the university, we're so pleased to see students returning to campus this new academic year. I can't tell you how exhilarating it is after such a long period of time of our campus being empty of most of our students. Just recently, the University of Melbourne hosted an event for Holi Festival supported by the Australia-India Institute, a very colourful event, and it's been just wonderful seeing our students back and enjoying life and these festivals on our campuses. I'm very pleased that we have some students here today in the room. We know education is a key pillar of the Australia-India relationship, and it's excellent that new opportunities have emerged through this interim free trade agreement for students choosing to live, study, and work in Australia and in Melbourne. It truly demonstrates the value that both governments are placing on leveraging our education ties and nurturing our people-to-people links. The University of Melbourne is home to Indian students, and as a world-class education provider, we strongly believe in the benefits of research and academic collaboration, building international student networks, and leveraging these networks of research expertise to find solutions for both Australia and India. You may know that the University of Melbourne and the Australia-India Institute currently has a delegation travelling in India, led by our Deputy Vice-Chancellor, Professor Michael Wesley, and the CEO of the Institute, the Honourable Lisa Singh. They are advancing the university's engagement with India's academic institutions, key government stakeholders, and alumni to help build capacity across both societies to meet the challenges of our shared future. There can be no doubt that the Australia-India relationship is one of the most strategically important relationships and is central to our internationalisation efforts. And we look forward to hearing more about the anticipated impact of the interim trade agreement from the ministers. It is my pleasure now to invite Mr. Alan Myers, the Chancellor of the University of Melbourne, to make some remarks. He is also the chair of the Australia-India Institute Board and the host of today's event. Chancellor.
Thank you very much, Provost. May I add to your welcome my own and the welcome of the Council of the University of Melbourne, to both our distinguished ministers. Thank you for being here. Also to the other representatives of India who are present here today, in particular His Excellency the High Commissioner and the Consul General in Melbourne. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a very, very great pleasure to be able to be present today. This is a highlight of the activities of the Australia-India Institute. The Institute is part of the University of Melbourne. It has been for 15 years since it was established. The University of Melbourne is not by accident the host of the Australia-India Institute. The relations between Australia and India and its educational institutions have always been front and centre and crucial for the international activities of the University of Melbourne, and will continue to be and will prosper even more with the signing of the agreement last Saturday. It's also not a matter of accident that the Chancellor of the University is also the chair of the Institute. It shows, I must say modestly, in a small way, the significance that the university attributes to the Institute. The work of the Institute, of course, is in the hands of others other than its advisory board, several of whose members are here today. And the Institute Chief Executive, Lisa Singh, can't be here, nor can Michael Wesley, both of whom were mentioned by the Provost, because they're in India, progressing the relationship of the university with that great country. But they regret, of course, that they're not here, although happy they are to be in India. One of the activities that the Institute conducts in India is to have an annual oration. This year it was delivered by the Australian High Commissioner to India, Barry O'Farrell. And I've been given a note of one of the things that he said. "For me, the biggest indicator of how far the Australia-India relationship has come is simply how frank, frequent, and trusting our interactions are with our Indian counterparts." One can only add, long may that continue. It's easy to be in love at first sight. It's more difficult to sustain the affection through the trials and tribulations of any relationship. However, I'm very confident that we at the university and Australia will do so with our Indian counterparts. The signing of the agreement, which has a very long title, there must be some acronym that has a wonderful meaning, I think, in that title. I can't imagine what it might be, but I hope it signifies harmony and unity between our countries. The signing of that agreement is obviously very important for the university, because it will encourage and enable the university to expand its connections with India, and our desire to receive the very, very many extremely clever Indian students whom the university has had the opportunity to receive to date will be enhanced, I'm sure, by a multitude of relationships which will come out of the, I'll call it simply, the Free Trade Agreement. One last observation. Now, after years of talking about this agreement and months of extremely hard work, I'm sure, bringing it to completion, to consummation, one stops and thinks, why has it taken so long? It's so obvious. A relationship between Australia and India, embodied in such an agreement, is simply obvious. We share so much, and our nations are complementary in so many ways. Not the same, but complementary. Now, I wasn't allowed to deliver a speech. I was just to welcome you, and I'm starting to warm up. This is a risk of asking a barrister to say something. It's my pleasure now to invite Minister Tehan to address you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Alan, and can I too pay my respects to the Indigenous people on lands upon which we meet, and in particular just note for those who haven't been to my electorate, the wonderful electorate of Wannon in Western Victoria, we have the most wonderful Indigenous cultural site called Butch Bim, where you can go back and see the earliest aquaculture which occurred in the world. And I would encourage everyone who hasn't been there to go and have a look at what our Indigenous people have offered in the past to us and what they continue to offer us into the present. Can I acknowledge everyone who's been acknowledged? Alan, it's wonderful to be here at Melbourne University, and thank you for hosting us. Former Premier Ted Baillieu, Indian High Commissioner, the Indian delegation who's here with us, welcome. But a particular warm welcome to my good friend, Piyush Goyal. Alan talked about why has it taken so long, and then quoted Barry O'Farrell about how the relationship now is one where we can talk frankly, where we can talk fearlessly, where we can talk openly and honestly. And I think that, above all, really goes to the tip or to the point of the relationship that I've been able to develop with Piyush. 7 months ago, I went to India, and our negotiations on IAECTA, as it's called, and Alan, there's a very good reason why it is called that. It came from the Indian side, and it came from the Indian Prime Minister, and it means unity in Hindu. So if we want a simple way to refer to it, we should refer to it as our unity agreement, because that's what it symbolises. But it was the fact that 7 months ago, Piyush and I were able to sit down over a meal in India, and it was meant to be a very short, brief meeting. We'd never met in person before, and I'd requested just 10 or 15 minutes by myself with Piyush just to try and get to know him. And we just hit it off. And before we knew it, Piyush was ordering lunch. We had an Indian banquet. It was the most superb Indian food. We had officials pacing up and down the room outside wondering what we were cooking up, very nervous, and we were able to broadly sketch an outline of the type of agreement which we were able to announce on Saturday. And we set ourselves the task to try and make sure that the 10 years that had previously been where we had tried to pull an agreement together, we would put behind us, and we would focus on getting an outcome that would truly represent the relationship. And it started as an interim agreement. Yet the further we talked and the more our teams worked together, and Amit, can I acknowledge your presence here today, the chief negotiator on the Indian side, and Francis Lisson on the Australian side, the more we talked, the more we pushed to make this not an interim agreement, but a substantial agreement. And on Saturday, what we're able to announce is of such significance that it stands on its own as a free trade agreement and will be registered at the World Trade Organization as such. So it is interim in nature, but not interim in its comprehensive capabilities. And it sets a platform for our two nations to continue to grow economically, the like of which we haven't seen before in our relationship. When I was here, I think it was 10 days ago, we were on the cusp of finalising it, but we hadn't quite nailed it. And I described it as a game of Quidditch, for those who know Harry Potter. And Piyush and I were flying around on our broomsticks trying to get that little snitch. And we just couldn't quite grab hold of it. But remarkably, our two prime ministers met in a leadership dialogue. And there in that leadership dialogue, they said to both of us, get this deal done. And within 4 days, we had the deal done. And can I offer my thanks, personal thanks, to Prime Minister Morrison and Prime Minister Modi, because without the relationship that they have, we wouldn't be here today, because it is one which is also built on that frank and fearless exchange and on that trust. They understand the geostrategic climate that both countries are operating in the Indo-Pacific. And through the Quad and through all the other dialogues they've had, they've been able to bring our two nations together to deal with that geostrategic uncertainty. And we shouldn't underestimate how important this agreement is, not only for on its economic capabilities, but also on how it will help us deal with the strategic issues that we are facing in the Indo-Pacific. And I point in particular to rare earths and critical minerals, which are going to be key ingredients in future supply chains going forward. And we have to make sure that those supply chains are diversified. And this agreement will enable us to do that in a key area where modern manufacturing in particular will rely on these key rare earths and critical minerals. So, Piyush, can I just say it is so wonderful to have you here in Australia. And it is so wonderful to have you here with the largest business delegation that has ever come to Australia. And the fact that we signed on Saturday, and here you are with that delegation here in Melbourne on Wednesday, I think points to your can-do approach. And I've got to say, above all else, that's what I enjoyed from our first meeting. There was no nonsense, there was no carry-on. It was, all right, this is what we need to get this done. We just worked on it and we got it done. And can I tell you, as a 16-year-old boy, I went with my family to India. And the warmth of the time that I had there, the warmth of the greetings, the way that we were welcomed has stuck with me right throughout my life. And there is nothing that has given me more joy, nothing that's given me more joy in my life in public office than being able to do this agreement. And for that, I owe you so much, Piyush. So thank you, and it's all yours.
Thank you very much, Provost Ms. Nicola Phillips. Thank you, Chancellor, for your very kind words. My good friend, Minister Dan Tehan, High Commissioner, Mr. Vora, Consul General, my colleagues from the Government of India, from the Government of Australia, all the distinguished guests who have joined us from Australia, friends who have joined me in this delegation from India, ladies and gentlemen, truly delighted to be back in Australia, a country that my family and I have always enjoyed being in, a lovely city Melbourne reminds me so much about Mumbai, where I've grown up all my life. And the weather today is just perfect for a Mumbaikar. It's what we love in Mumbai. A little bit of rain, the cool surroundings, and what a lovely day to start by visiting the medical facilities and the research center, because truly it's great to be getting out now, back to university, back to school, back to our international engagements. Hopefully COVID should be behind us, or at least the serious parts of it should be behind us. And therefore, a mark of respect for all those who gave their lives, our frontline medical workers, doctors, technicians, nurses, who really served the world, if I may say. Certainly India, but across the world, who have contributed to saving lives. I think we owe them one. We owe them for all that they've done for the world. I'm also told that you had a Shane Warne memorial last week at the Melbourne Cricket Ground. I think all of India admired Shane Warne. He was truly a remarkable cricketer, the king of spin, as they would call him. And all of us have mourned his passing away at a very young age. My deepest condolences to his family and to all his friends here. Because I'll never forget that he used to paste himself with that white. Yeah, he was unique in more ways than one. And for all the cricket lovers in India and of course in Australia, a big loss that can never be really made up. I must thank the Australia-India Institute and thank you, Chancellor Alan Mayers, for hosting me here this morning. You'll be happy to know that your institute was discussed in the Union Cabinet when we finalized this agreement. And I was in fact told that I must engage with the Australian Indian Institute to understand what's happening in Australia, the dimensions of business and economics across the country, and also the geopolitical significance of our partnership. So I can only share with you that you're very well recognized in India. You're very well acknowledged for the good work that the Institute has done. And ever since your establishment in 2008, I think you've played a very instrumental role in taking our relations to greater heights, somewhat like the Doncaster Hill here. And the kind of research, the kind of work that comes out from your institute, it gives us a lot of insights into the potential of our partnership. You have earned a very good reputation back home in India for the way you have been able to build bridges between the two countries. And of course, ever since our Padma Shri winner, one of the highest civilian awards, Mr. Amitabh Mattoo, founded this institute under the Melbourne University of Melbourne, and its current leadership of Her Excellency Senator Lisa Singh. I think we have a long way to work together and take this institute to greater heights and continue to play an important role in our work together. Thank you. Friends, I'm told that Australia and India were one country or one continent thousands of years ago. At least the map seems to suggest that. If you try to dovetail the two continents together, and the brothers were separated many, many, many thousands of years ago. I think the unity agreement, as you very appropriately put it, gives us an opportunity to get back that brotherhood, that fraternity, that togetherness that I think was rightly due. You're talking of 10 years. I personally think we are probably 50 years too late. This is a relationship where we could have naturally helped each other over the last decades and decades to grow, to prosper, to take a better future for the people of both countries forward. And, well, as they say, there's a word in Hindi, there's a saying, "Der aaye durust aaye." Even though you may be late, but it's good that you are there. And I think that's the sentiment that the Indus Ekta Agreement has for all of us back home in India. I hope for Australia also, that delayed but never too late. And I think we now need to catch up. The fact that we could conclude it in 6 months, and really out of that 6 months, if you look at the October to December period, we had the Omicron wave across continents, we had Christmas and the New Year. So I still recall that call on video on the 4th of January, when we really got cracking. And from the 4th of January to the day we signed on 2nd of April, I think it was truly a labor of love between our two teams, who sweated it out, worked mindless hours all through day and night to come up with, to my mind, a truly phenomenal outcome for the time span that they got. And looking at the way this relationship is prospering on the political front, on the geopolitical, economic and strategic front, my own sense is that it's the right time, it's an appropriate time, it's a great message to the whole world. And the first free trade agreement that India has executed in a decade, and the first with a developed nation after many, many years. So truly, I think this kind of signifies the strength and the resilience of our two countries, of our two leaders, Prime Minister Modi and Prime Minister Morrison, as Minister Tehan rightly said, are really wonderful friends. And the defining feature in that friendship is trust. The fact that you can have a trusted friend, I think, is worth its weight in gold, particularly in today's day and age, where, as Chancellor said, there are many clever people. I hope they're not only clever, but they're also serious and studious and smart. But I do believe that there's a lot that is in this unity agreement for all of us. Minister Tehan has earlier been the education minister. He has consistently advocated greater engagement between our universities. He has been at the forefront of trying to get dual degrees between Australia and India, trying to get mutual recognition of our educational qualifications between the two nations, trying to expand the dimensions of our education partnership. And I'm delighted to share with you that we are already at a very advanced stage of entering into an agreement between Australia and India on greater collaboration on the education front. It should be any day soon that we hope to take that forward. And I do hope that the University of Melbourne will play an important role in our future plans together. Of course, you spoke about your being a barrister. Reminded me of my days in law college. Of course, sadly, I was less in the classroom, more in the canteen. But still enjoyed my studies there. It was absolutely fabulous to learn to be a lawyer. And I still remember we had a very, very famous luminary, legal luminary called Ram Jethmalani. He was one of the tallest lawyers that India has ever produced. He passed away, unfortunately, a couple years ago, ripe old age of 90 plus, young at 90. Enjoyed life to the T, but he was a fantastic lawyer. And when I finished my chartered accountancy and law, which I did in both in 87, and chose to go down the path of business and the finance world, he was very disappointed. And he told my father, what are you doing sending him into business and all of that? Send him to me. I'll make a good lawyer out of him. I wish I'd taken up that offer, because then I could have probably negotiated a little smarter with Dan. I hope I didn't let go too much. But truly, ever since Prime Minister Modi came to Australia and to this lovely city, probably November of 2014, I think our relations have just been on an upward trajectory ever since then. Prime Minister Modi sees a very special significance in the partnership and the friendship of Australia, its leadership and its people. I must acknowledge the role that my good friend, and this morning we've been exchanging messages, or rather started last night, but we've just concluded by deciding to use the word mate more often for each other. But I must say, Tony played an absolutely phenomenal role in making this relationship, I think, a defining feature of this century, and really a stepping stone to lots more to come in the years ahead. Tony was at it, very committed to this partnership. He was always there to smoothen the edges, should there have been any problem. And the fact that he's a tall leader, he's a person who everybody respects tremendously, both in India and in Australia. The fact that he could pick up the phone and talk to Prime Minister Modi, and I suspect the same with Prime Minister Morrison, really helped to kind of iron out any issues that off and on would crop up in such a negotiation. So a great acknowledgement is due, and a deep sense of gratitude to Mr. Tony Abbott, the former Prime Minister of Australia. Well, somewhat this partnership is becoming like your famous Australian cricket opening pair of Justin Langer and Matthew Hayden. Very difficult to break the wall. And I think the values that we share really help us in defining this partnership. The rule of law, the way that we believe in transparent systems of government, our shared values of democracy, the fact that we both emerged out of the Commonwealth. And I was just thinking, Mr. Tehan, that look at the significance. We first did the deal with you. We had active negotiations with the United Kingdom. And we've recently launched Canada negotiations. So three Commonwealth nations with whom we share very, very good relations. And the four of us were really good friends. Are we in for another quart? But it's been a journey. I think this relationship has, over the years, probably had more of a people-to-people connect than the business connect. But it's a great way to begin, because it's people who are going to define our business relations in the future. And therefore, our focus has been a lot on the human dimensions of the India-Australia partnership. As I said, education was one. Research is another area that we had the good fortune to get a sense of, or a little bit of a exposure to earlier in the day. Very impressive work going on the medical research side. I was delighted to know that you started work on the SARS-type viruses somewhere in 2014 when the world first got a whiff of this problem. And I do believe when I get back, I'm going to suggest to my science and technology team and my agriculture research team to look at greater engagement with Australia. There's a lot we can learn. And there's a huge set of people and large amounts of businesses there, or large amounts of people engaged in the medical field or in agriculture, who can benefit tremendously from a greater partnership with Australia. Of course, we've also got a lot of work to do in the field of startups. That's another area that I think we can work together. I have always believed, and I think it's a good opportunity to leave some food for thought for the Institute to work on, that every country has an investable surplus. Every country. Could be different for different countries. For example, in India, we look at our 1.35 billion people, our demographic dividend, as we call them many times, as our strength. I don't look at them, the Prime Minister doesn't look at them as a liability. We look at them as our biggest strength. The fact that we have such a big market, the fact that our people aspire for a better quality of life, the fact that each one of them now is exposed to the world through internet, through television, sees what's happening in the rest of the world, wants to be a part of that growth story, gives you a huge opportunity, both for Indian businesses and for businesses around the world. It helps us when we look at trying to expand our education facilities. It helps when we're looking at creating new infrastructure. We have a $1.4 trillion infrastructure pipeline for the next 10, 12 years. And that's the level of investments that are possible in a developing country like India. Similarly, Australia's investable surplus comes out of money, your investment capability in terms of literally money that you need to invest to get a fair return to pay for your pensions, to pay for your health care, to pay for the growth or the development of the Australian economy. And I think that's where the marriage has huge dimensions, the marriage between Australia and India. Your investable surplus can get huge opportunities to get a fair return in India, and our investable surplus, the people of India, can help create opportunities for businesses in Australia, for educational institutions in Australia. It can give you a large pool of trained manpower with skills which are unmatched, whether in the IT space, whether in engineering, whether in medicine, law, accountancy. And together, this marriage can truly have far-reaching dimensions for both our economies, and if I dare say, for the rest of the world also, where we can collectively engage and have an outreach to other parts of the world. For instance, you do some very good research, come up with a very good product, but given the small market that we have in Australia, to be able to really manufacture at scale, at an affordable or a competitive price, becomes very difficult. But when you have a 1.4 billion people market sitting out there, the scale at which you can produce your goods suddenly becomes completely different. That scale brings with it economies of manufacturing, of production, of amortizing your research costs. And that scale then helps you to become competitive not only in Australia, not only in India, but in the rest of the world. So that's where I think the research, the technologies, the capabilities that Australia has, the fact that you are endowed with so much of natural resources, coupled with the Indian demand, the Indian manufacturing ecosystem, the Indian market, and then the world as a market from India. This partnership can help both countries prosper and grow in the years to come. Of course, we'll also have to set right many other related issues. For example, our shipping connectivity, our air connectivity, all of that will also need to be upgraded. So therefore, as Minister Tehan said, this is a beginning, but a great beginning. It's a substantive beginning. I've already talked to DP World, for example, in the United Arab Emirates last week when I was there, that they may look at expanding direct shipping lines and connectivity to Australia from India. We are looking at greater engagement in the field of accountancy, in the field of engineering, in the IT world, between the two countries. And I'm delighted that we've been able to resolve a long-pending issue about taxation of the IT industry that was kind of holding back greater business with Australia. That being behind us is huge potential. And I shared yesterday with Tony and the rest of the friends who were there that India's IT industry has grown from $1 billion in the year 2000 in its export to $178 billion the year gone by, 31st March, a 20% or thereabouts CAGR in 22 years. And we actually started out trying to solve the Y2K bug. If you recall the 99 to 2000, the turn of the century, the millennium bug. And here we are from 1 billion to 178 billion and counting. And therefore, I believe that technology engagement between the two countries will also play a very important role as we move forward. We have very ambitious targets for our services side to serve the world. So while on the one hand, we want to make in India for the world, we also want to serve the world from India. And collectively, I think the potential of this relationship is huge. We've set very modest targets. We are looking at taking the $26, $27 billion bilateral trade to about $50 billion in the next 5 years. Totally unacceptable to Minister Tehan and me. This is just not what we put in all this hard work for. And I would suggest that our teams seriously drill down, just like we did at the agreement stage. We drill down sector by sector, how we are going to grow this relationship on the fast lane. And let's be more ambitious. Let's look at $100 billion, and I'm saying US dollar. So that would probably be about 140 billion Australian dollar engagement between India and Australia. Shall we say by 2030? That gives you 8 years. That's more than you require. So we are looking at a quadrupling of this relationship in 8 years. I hope CII is listening. I hope Vicky is listening. I hope the Foreign Office is listening. And certainly the Ministry of Commerce and Industry is committed to making it happen. And I think the very fact that having decided on this trip on Thursday, when I was probably in UAE, conveying to my team on Friday that I want to go to Australia with a delegation comprising people of varied interests who are interested in business with Australia, who are interested in exports or imports, both. We have both over here with Australia, and I want them put in place by the weekend. And I'm grateful to my team who worked 36 hours reaching out to all the export promotion councils, industry associations, and we have one of the largest delegations led by Mr. Narendran, who's the chairman of CII, the Confederation of Indian Industry, also managing director of Tata Steel, somebody who does big business with Australia. He just was mentioning about importing $2 billion worth of Australian goods to India last year. We'll have to have a conversation, Mr. Narendran. I'll have to have you balance that with 2 billion of export next year to Australia. But great, I think it's the bilateral relationship which is going to take us forward. We have a number of pharma companies here. We have companies from textiles. We have companies from the leather industry. I have representatives of our service sector. The Services Export Promotion Council is represented here, chartered accountants with me. We have a number of companies who have already set up base in Australia who have joined the delegation from the IT space, from the mining space. So truly a great opportunity to celebrate this unity agreement. I hope the Australia-India University will drill down the opportunities, help us create the roadmap to the $100 billion target by 2030, reset business processes wherever required, guide both the governments in newer areas of engagement, and my own sense is it's not impossible. Most people didn't believe we could do this agreement ever at all. Large number of people never thought it's possible in the time frames we finally did it in. But we are now one. That's what the unity agreement is all about. And at this watershed moment in our relations, I think it's only appropriate that we break every barrier between the two countries, whether it's movement of goods, services, people, technology, education, science, medical knowledge. We break all these barriers, see how we can work together as two brothers. Let's see some more Tasmania lobsters in New Delhi, possibly. Or wine from South Australia coming down into Indian shelves. We'll probably have a lot more Bangaloreans coming down to Melbourne to serve you in your IT space. We'll have a lot more jewelers from Prime Minister's home state of Gujarat, from Surat, coming down to sell their wares in the stores in Australia. Lots to do together, lot of potential in different areas. I hope this partnership will grow, and we will all grow along with this partnership. My sincerest gratitude once again to the University of Melbourne for hosting us, giving us this platform. My gratitude to Minister Tehan, to High Commissioner Barry O'Farrell in New Delhi, both of them pillars of this relationship. Thank you both to High Commissioner Mr. Vora in Australia and the Consul General in Melbourne. Thank you, Amit, and thank you, Frances. She's not here, for the wonderful work both of them have done. And just like the University of Melbourne's motto says, and I quote, "May I grow in the esteem of future generations." I hope that this partnership, starting from the Indus Ekta Agreement, will certainly give us great esteem in the eyes of future generations. Thank you very much.
Minister, thank you so much for that. I'm told that we have a short amount of time for some questions. May I invite the ministers and the chancellor to take a seat here.
Good morning. My name is Vish Vishwanathan. I'm the chair of the national chair for the Make in India chapter, which is the Prime Minister's vision. We want to implement in Australia, make it in India, but make it for Australia. That is the mission of this chapter. And I'm also assisting the agribusiness chapter. I've got one question for each of you, Honorable Piyush Goyalji, as well as Dantian. Honorable Dantian, just like Vietnam, is it possible to have agribusiness visas for India so that the from India people can come and work in farms here? And that is something which is a good thing, because in spite of the COVID, agribusiness has been growing between India and Australia. So that's a question to you. And to Honorable Piyush Goyalji, Make in India is the vision of the Prime Minister. And how can we, this agreement, ECTA agreement, enhance that vision, which is good for Australia? What aspects of the ECTA will be, we can promote it here from Australia-India Business Council? These are the two questions.
Well, thank you. And the mobility part of the unity agreement is a key part. And as Payush mentioned, it will be wonderful when it comes to our international students, whether they be Indian international students here in Australia, the post-study work rights that they get under this agreement in those key areas of information technology and STEM are absolutely vital. There is post-study work rights which flow from this agreement to those students, so they'll be able to stay longer, work longer in those key areas. And one of the requirements that we have is that the students have to get first-class honours. So it will be the best and the brightest of the Indian international students who will stay here and work. We've also got mobility changes when it comes to Indian yoga instructors, when it comes to Indian chefs. One of the things that I love is Indian food. So although it was a request from Payush that we could get more Indian chefs, it was one that I thought should have been an ask from the Australian point of view rather than the Indian point of view. So there's also changes which have been made there. And given the nature of the agreement, and it's a living agreement, we want to look and see whether we can expand mobility in other areas. So down the track, there is no reason why we couldn't look at whether agricultural visa workers or other sections of society that we need here where we're looking for workforce and continue to grow and develop the mobility side of this agreement. So it's a very good question and one which we have under active consideration and will continue to work on as the agreement enters into force.
Well, I think the best part of the Australia-India relation is that we complement each other. Manufacturing is a relatively smaller portion of the Australian economy. It's largely a services-driven economy, and a lot of it is about minerals and the huge bountiful wealth that they have in Australia on the mining mineral side. India, on the other hand, has to provide for 1.4 billion people, so we need to focus a lot on manufacturing, which is why the Make in India program is very important. That's where a large part of our employment will get generated, hopefully giving the young boys and girls formal engagement, help our startups come up with unique innovations. It'll also be important because end of the day, the world, which is fast moving into the services space in a big way, will need competitively manufactured products. And therefore, India, through its Make in India program, can support technologies which may have been developed in Australia to become competitive, to be produced at high quality for the world from India. As Minister said, there may be certain technologies which would be exploited or manufactured in Australia, for which Indian talent can also help play a role. So I think both countries have a very balanced outcome that the Indus ECTA agreement represents. It's basically a win-win for both countries. So where our manufactured goods, like in the textile space or jewelry space or leather space, pharmaceutical, where we are called the pharmacy of the world, probably the third largest manufacturer of medicines. In different areas, we have looked at pathways to expand the engagement. Our automobile industry has huge potential also. Our service sector, you know, our chartered accountants and different professionals are serving in a big way in Australia. Going forward in the post-COVID world, there's going to be a lot of work which may not require mobility also. With work from home taking center stage and 2 years of experience, I think a lot of work would get outsourced even without the mobility of people. So I think the future opens up a lot of new opportunities in a variety of sectors. And the fact that we are complementing each other, they help us with raw materials which make our products more competitive for India and for the rest of the world. The fact that we can give manufactured goods of high quality to Australia for the Australian people and the market. The fact that we can engage with each other on technologies, research. And after my visit this morning, I'm very keen that we should look at a greater degree of collaboration between education and research in the two countries. In fact, if I may venture to suggest, we have an Institute of Foreign Trade, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade in India under my ministry. We would be very delighted to consider some kind of a collaboration in which the University of Melbourne and my Institute of Foreign Trade could see whether there are any common programs or any synergies that we could take forward.
One expects that ag tech, agricultural technology, should be a natural place,
right.
One of the natural places to start, and we shall investigate that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Unfortunately, the ministers are on tight schedules, as you would expect, and so we will need to leave the questions there. But it remains for me to thank the ministers, the chancellor, everybody here for such a rich and engaging discussion about the opportunities that are presented by this historic agreement. I'd like to thank Minister Goyal, Minister Tien, and you, Chancellor, for hosting this occasion. And to you all for your attendance this morning, and to invite you to enjoy some refreshments with us in the room next door. Thank you very much indeed.